It would be just about that time that we should find our seats, get any old seat you want, musical chair, you can choose a new one. There's probably more seats than people, so that's okay. We also, at this time, before we enter into worship, share any announcements for the life of the church. So let me just I'll remember it later. But
I just wanted to remind people, if you want to participate in dinner for 7/8 this coming year, please sign up with Kit. Always need a coffee hour. And if you if you're part of the women's group, or even if you aren't, if you're interested in going to the tea house, the last Wednesday in May, the tea house is closing June 10th. So you want to go.
Closing permanently?
They hope to find a new spot.
The tea house is over in Bridgeton. The women of the church are going to go over and have a tea together. We've been doing this once a year. Other announcements that anybody has for the life of the church, the community? So let me just say that yesterday, many helping hands came to the church and helped clean it up and spruce up over the last few weeks. People have been coming and volunteering and clearing away whatever was uncovered once the snow thawed. And we're looking pretty good now. Also, I know Jeanette and many other people were at the Women Build for Habitat for Humanity yesterday, which it, was it in Socorro or Tamworth?
Tamworth.
There have been a lot of amazing events going on in the valley, and also I at least got to go to a dance performance by Jean Limmer's Dance Company, and that was moving on so many beautiful levels. So for all the ways that art and life are blooming in the world, and that we're cleaning up and paying attention to what's around us, this is a blessing. There's an announcement on the back of the bulletin. It's wrong. It says there's a class today after church. There's no such thing. I would never plan a class on Mother's Day. I don't want to be obligated to having a class on Mother's Day. So, no class. And I guess there's something else. Yes?
A couple of afternoons ago, John and I were walking in the village late in the afternoon, and who was setting up to paint the front of the church?
Yes.
Bob Harper comes here it all by himself, and he was here until he changed it. At least it must be the first coat or something. But anyway, it certainly looked a whole lot better, so the open thing.
That's right.
So I'll let everybody else that helps out. But he was here this night.
So Bob Harper paints at the front, and I would say that Steve Weeder showed up with a chainsaw yesterday. So what people were doing all kinds of things. Steve took down a whole dead tree, and he did it like really fast. Pretty amazing.
Yeah, this has to do with yesterday too. I can't even saw, but if anyone is upset with some of the branches, this is legit. As you're leaving the parking lot. I got started, and anyway, I own it, so if you're upset, it's safer, I can tell you that, and I went over one tree too far, which made it even worse, but I own it, I have it, and I'm saying this for one audience in particular, and that's the church ladies, so that I got the topic out there on the table. And the other thing is, I'm sure Angie is happy today because it's Mother's Day, and I think I did the right thing. I got to go do some work. Thank you.
Yes, Tony cleared away and trimmed several branches for us. We had people washing windows, cleaning the kitchen, cleaning up the whole thing. So lots and lots of people to thank. Any more announcements? Then why don't we rise and we will begin with music. There's Psalm 220 in red hymnal, Breathe on Me, Breath of God. Mm-hmm. today. I think you can guess what it is, Mother's. So welcome to Mother's Day here. And please join me in the call to worship. You can also find me in the bulletin. This day we lift up to you those women who gave us life. May you who conceived and created us pour out your blessing on the women, those who have in their turn been the embodiment of love for us.
May you who love us by our creations, hold your community, those beautiful strong women who have been mothers and mentors, sisters and friends, guides and healers, teachers and leaders.
We give thanks where we have seen your face in her face, met your light and your love in her.
We ask your compassion for every mother who has known what we cause pain and suffering.
We lift into your care the heart of every mother who has loved and lost.
We call your attention to our every mother of the earth. We create the gift of mothering love, gentle and fierce, strong and
silence so that you can sit with love however you need it or know it, and you be present to it and ask love to be present to you. Are there any prayers of celebration or unconcern that you wish to say out loud today? Cheryl's Uncle Jim, who passed away at the age of 96, and for his family and friends, for gratitude for his long life, and for comfort for those who are saying goodbye to him. Other prayers for the life of the church, for the community. There were a few that were raised up at the 8 o'clock this morning. Tony and Jay and Pam, all of these families have a new cancer diagnosis or an existing cancer diagnosis. And so we pray for people, not just these two families, but so many people. People here in this congregation sitting among us now, or people whose beloved ones, not in this room, are living with cancer. We also think of other diagnoses. Right? We think about diabetes, we think about ALS. My husband isn't here today because he was at the memorial of a friend who lived and died due to ALS. Sudden changes in our bodies, long, chronic changes in our bodies, Alzheimer's and dementia, stroke. There are so many things that change our mobility and remind us that we are vulnerable, and yet amazing things can happen inside our bodies because of these challenges and in spite of them. Love is present in every one of us, regardless of our condition. So we give both thanks and we ask for healing and comfort and dignity for those who are living with changes. We think about matriarchs today. And when we say mothers, we don't just think about mothers and grandmothers. We think about aunts. We think about sisters. We think about our daughters and our nieces and our cousins. And we think about our close friends. And we think about the teachers, the coaches, the many women who in one form or another have been mentoring and mothering to us. And for those of us who may not claim the exact title mother, but who we have also given out love to young men and young women in our own lives, for whom we have been that source of safety and wisdom and learning. This day is a recognition of all women and the roles that we play in the world and of the women who are growing up and becoming all that they might yet be. We give thanks for things that remind us to be grateful and to celebrate. And Epoch also named some wildlife sightings. Apparently there have been some moose around. And there's a baby bear. Did anybody hear about this? There's a baby bear that was way underweight. It was only 10 pounds instead of 40 pounds. And so it's been rescued, and it is under the care of, there's a wildlife person named Jim. He's nursing this baby bear back to, as a cub to growth. So for people that adopt and love those that need extra help, we also give thanks. Are there any spring sightings that have helped you remember why you're glad to be here? Yes?
A hummingbird.
A hummingbird. Yes? Are,
I'm looking at that extraordinary bouquet that's up there. It's just all the spray flowers. And we just remember that from the media and everywhere, the yellow, the weeping willow already in yellow now. I mean, it's just, it's raw, and it was just beautiful, and I'm grateful for it.
So for these flowers, the ones that Joyce created for us today, which was, they come out of her yard, and ours saying they drove back from Acadia, Maine, and they saw yellow everywhere. Even the weeping willow was yellow. So the golden radiance of the world right now, that special color that is spring that goes away again so soon, it's so fleeting. Anything else? Then please pray with me. Oh, holy love, however we know you and recognize you, we ask that you will help us hold on to the things that give life meaning, the fleeting moments of noticing the color of a flower or the flight of a bird, and the long and enduring relationships that we have with the people in our lives, the places in our lives, the many ways that love holds us and reminds us that we are beloved, that we are the children of grace and love, and that we are filled with amazing potential. We give thanks for this love. We ask that this love, this healing, this justice, this mercy will be present where it is most needed, whether it is in places where violence has happened, such as schools where death has occurred, or nations like those that are so challenged, such as Zimbabwe, the mother nation of our partner church, the Chikanga Church in the city of Mutare, and so many other places. We ask for wisdom where wisdom is needed, certainly among our national leaders and our international leaders. We ask that what we take for granted should become available in places where it is not, the freedom to speak your mind, to be educated, to expect shelter, potable water, food, a vote. May these things come to all people. We ask that you will hear our silence. Ask that you will hear us as we pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Before we start with the blessing, I'm going to ask Judy and Jeanette to come forward. They have a song for us. To do is we're going to recognize women today. And we're going to start with women that have either born children or adopted children. Would you raise your hand if you are such a woman? And keep your hand up because this guy's going to have to find you. Now, if you don't identify as a mom who either bore or adopted a child, are you a person who has been a teacher or a mentor or a coach to other young women? If you are, please raise your hand. And let's see, is there anybody that still doesn't identify in some way? I think that's every woman so far. And if you're not identifying as a mother or a teacher or a mentor, or guide, are you the daughter of a woman? Or do you have a sister or a grandmother or somebody significant who helped to raise you? All women, I'm asking everyone. Alright, I think that we can safely say that all women have now been recognized. You guys can raise your hands as daughters. wants a particular color, feel free to give them a particular color. You can ask people what color they want. So Tish Hanlon is going to be our speaker this morning in just a few minutes. But before we begin, we want to have this blessing of mothers. And I wanted to read a few passages from Annie Lamott's essay on Mother's Day, because this is a challenging holiday for some people, and I think it's important to recognize that before we just go ahead and be all happy and rainbows. Mother's Day celebrates a huge lie about the value of women. The mothers are superior beings and that they have done more with their lives and chosen a more difficult path. Every woman's path is difficult, and many mothers were as equipped to raise children as wire monkey mothers. I say that without judgment. It's true, sadly. An unhealthy mother's love is withering. The holiday is all non-mothers, and the daughters of dead mothers, and the mothers of dead or severely damaged children feel the deepest kind of grief and failure. The non-mothers must sit in their churches, temples, mosques, recovery rooms, and pretend to feel good about the day while they were excluded from a holiday that benefits no one but Hallmark. Don't get me wrong. There were times I could have literally died of love for my son, and I felt stone on his rich, desperate love for me. But I bristle at the whispered lie that you can know this level of love and self-sacrifice only if you are a parent. My main gripe about Mother's Day is that it feels incomplete and imprecise. The main thing that ever helped mothers was other people mothering them. A chain of mothering that keeps the whole shebang afloat. I am the woman I grew to be partly in spite of my mother, and partly because of the extraordinary love of her best friends, and my own best friends' mothers, and from surrogates, many of whom were not women, but were men. I have loved them my entire life, even after their passing. No one is more sentimentalized in America than mothers on Mother's Day. But no one is often more blamed for the culture's bad people and behavior. You want to give me chocolate and flowers? Great. I love them both, and I just don't want you to give them to me out of guilt, and I don't want them if you're not going to give them to all the people who helped mother our children. If you are going to include everyone, then you can make mine something like M&Ms and maybe flowers you picked yourself from your own garden. The cut stems wrapped in wet paper towels, then tin foil and wax paper bag from my kitchen drawers. I don't want something special. I want something beautifully plain, like everything else. It can fill me only if it is ordinary and available to all. Let us recognize that Mother's Day means more than just the women who gave birth to us, that it is for all women who have shaped us in so many different ways. Will the men in this congregation please read with me, and will the women read to each other as you read together the blessing of the mothers, which you can also find on the insert in your bulletin. Who are our first sanctuary? Who fashion a space of blessing with their own being, with the belly, the bone, the blood, or if not with these, then with the durable heart that offers itself to break and grow wide, to gather itself around another as refuge, as home. Who lean into the wonder and terror of loving what they can hold but cannot contain. Who remain in some part of themselves always awake, a corner of consciousness keeping perpetual vigil. We know that the story is what endures, is what binds us, is what runs deeper even than blood. And so they spin them in celebration of what abides and benediction of what remains, a simple gladness that latches onto us and graces us on our way. Bless you. Lord, welcome forward. There are a bunch of scriptures on the back of that insert. I offer them because it's important for women to know how they are written about in our sacred scriptures. I'm going to have you just read the one for me. Just the one for me.
One that and the one all the way above.
Just the book.
Oh, good morning. And Mary said, my soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior, for he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He's brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham, and to his descendants forever.
And now Tish will come forward.
On, you know, mothers, I have many, I have to admit that my first instinct at speaking about being a mother on Mother's Day was, I am not an expert on motherhood, and I don't think I can speak about it. And earlier this week, I was reading an online book review, and it was about how to raise successful children. The author, an obviously proud mother and journalist, had three daughters, a doctor and two CEOs. And as I read, I found myself slowly being pulled into this rabbit hole of doubt and questioning my own parenting strategies once again. I thought a lot about, you know, what Anne Lamott was saying about the commercialization about Mother's Day. And I have somewhat of a problem with that, but then you hear about some people saying that every day is Mother's Day. But that's really not how it feels. It's certainly not how it feels for me and for most mothers. And I came into this role of being a mother at advanced maternal age, like Sarah in the Bible, I've been thinking. And but she was even older than me. And because of that, because I was a non-mother for a very long time in my life, I too feel that it's so important to recognize women who do not have children, but who display extraordinary nurturing instincts, the mentors and advocates and the confidants that we've all had in our lives. But I speak to you today from the trenches of motherhood and daughterhood, for that matter. I feel deep in the weeds of life while I'm caring for aging and health-challenged parents, and I'm watching over my teens. But I feel that I am a fortunate soul, as my feet are firmly planted, and I am aware that this too will pass, and all too quickly. I am trying hard these days to be very present. And I think of the Buddhist quote, as you walk and eat and travel, be where you are. Otherwise, you will miss most of your life. Please take note that my 17 and 18-year-old children are home sleeping while I am here at church on Mother's Day. Maybe they're preparing a brunch. I don't think so. But I am feeling gratitude today, and I'm praying for guidance and strength. I come to this community church because I feel a connection here. I know I can bring my imperfect self here and feel love and hope. I'm reminded that I'm not alone and that there is so much important work to do. My faith life has taken a winding path since being married and having children. My husband Stephen and I were both raised Catholic, and this foundational identity was important to us growing up. I attended Catholic schools for 16 years. As Irish immigrants, my parents had a strong connection to their parish. And I suppose this is why Stephen and I sought out a church home of our own, and one that was more aligned with our life and our values. I do miss certain things about the Catholic Church, the rituals and the prayers, but mostly the stature of Mary. And I'm happy that Mary is highlighted in the scripture today, because when I first learned to pray, it was mostly to Mary, asking her to intercede on my behalf with God. I have been thinking about Mary's life in preparing to speak today. I've been imagining her, Mary, a young single virgin girl, finding herself pregnant and unwed. Was she shunned? Were the villagers whispering about her around the well? Were they judging her? I have been thinking about Jesus and Mary's relationship. What must it have been like? Was he thought of as a quirky kid? Did people consider him a savant or a know-it-all? Were people afraid of him? And then, of course, he didn't hang out with the best crowd, really. He hung out with the money exchangers and the prostitutes And then he got so close to the outcasts of society, the lepers and the untouchables. Mary had her hands full with him, I guess. And she must have been worried, sick, or praying 24/7. And then for him to be killed the way he was, with everyone mocking him, and his most trusted friends betraying him and denying their friendship. She must have felt so helpless. Imagine the faith and hope her journey as a mother required. It's helpful for me to consider this because I think Mary would understand the challenges of current-day parenting. The social media, the cyberbullying, the school safety concerns, the anxiety, the addictions. Often these days when I have a quiet moment, as I walk or garden or drive back and forth to Boston, I find myself saying a Hail Mary, full of grace, that prayer. Not just for me, but for the world and all of God's children. I don't think I would consider myself a natural born mother. Not being a mother, is the most humbling and gratifying journey I have ever been on. I have been blessed with great role models, my mom, my mother-in-law, my sisters and sisters-in-law, and this preparingness has got me to think about that. I have 12 between sisters and sister-in-law. I have 12. And many friends. Where would I be without their advice and their support? Their let's talk. Their let's have a cup of tea. Let's go for a walk. Without their love, I count them among my most precious belongings. My mom had 5 kids, and as God is my witness, as she would say, I don't remember her raising her voice with us. My kids cannot say the same about me. I do remember lots of little altars and framed holy paintings around our house with the images of the Madonna and Child and the Infant of Prague. These tangible reminders of the importance of the mother and child relationship were lost on me at the time, but they're not lost on me now. My mom left her home in the far west of Ireland when she was 18, my kid's age. Her mom was too sad to say goodbye, so she took to the bed for the day, the story goes. 6 of her 9 children emigrated to England or America. Imagine the loss she felt. How my mom navigated her way in America still confounds me. She was raised without plumbing or electricity or a secondary education. But I do know she was bolstered by strong aunts and supportive sisters, and she was a quick study. My mom prayed a lot, and she laughed a lot, and she still does. One of the best pieces of mothering advice I have ever received is, you can't put old heads on young shoulders. It's something my mother-in-law reminds me of time and time again. She also has this habit of catching me and all those in her life doing something right and telling you she's proud of you. What a gift. I have come to understand prayer as a form of meditation. It's turning it over. It's letting go. It's surrendering and ultimately finding relief. And I think it's at this juncture of surrender and relief that we find grace. I've been wondering lately if grace just might be enlightenment, and I'm still pondering this. Truthfully, I know I feel deep in the weeds of life, but I'm equally aware that my cup runneth over. I'm a teenager sleeping at home, but with the help of God and family and friends and community, they will be leaving the nest and heading off to college or work and just strike out on their own life adventures. And in the end of the day, I will feel successful if my children know that they were deeply loved and that in turn, they will do the critical and the important work of being loving and kind human beings. I would like you to join me today to share in a moment of quiet gratitude and prayer for mothers and surrogate mothers everywhere, for mothers whose children are in harm's way, for mothers whose children have died, for mothers and caregivers who rise each day to do their best despite enormous obstacles, for mothers and children seeking a safe and legal passage to immigration. May they find strength through connection. May their burdens be made lighter by the power of grace and God's work being done right here on this earth. Amen. Happy Mother's Day once again.
As Tish requested, let us hold that moment of gratitude for mothers and for those who have mothered us, for daughters, for sons, for all those who have known the love of a woman. And would you rise, if you are able, to sing the song, Like a Mother Who Has Borne Us. We're going to do verses 1, 3, and 4, page 89. And we met a new baby who I told you about 2 weeks ago. Born the day before Easter. And I was thinking about this mom because she has been homeless. She's living in a safe place right now. She has 3 other children. And I was thinking about kind of what Tish was talking about. If you think about the story of Christmas, Christ's mother was homeless. And so the qualification to be a mother is not that you are smart enough or resourceful enough or fortunate enough to have all the right resources to take care of your child. Because the mother that we met this week goes someplace else to do her laundry, and we help them with all kinds of things like food and things like that. But what she's really good at is loving her children. She's a very imperfect woman. And the man who's the father of this child is an imperfect father, but there is no way that could ever love their children more fiercely than they will love their children. But what it takes is not just the two of them, it takes all of us to make love possible and to make a child's life better than the lives of the parents that came before. And so we as a community are called to do that. And when you are generous with us, you pass that generosity back out, and sometimes it's actually in the shape of a mother who is literally holding a child in her arms and doing a load of laundry and just trying one day at a time to have a better life for her family. So we thank you for the ways that you have given to us so that we can make love possible in the world for families right here in this valley. Thank you. And please rise for the doxology. And so now, if you would like to turn to page 153, what child is this? Ooh, I bet we know that one. It's a Christmas song. We'll sing that one, and then we'll go into blessing, and then there's good food if you want it, or you can ring the bell, or whatever makes you happy.
Thank you. loving love that calls you by your name,
your right name,
and walks out in the world with you, loving you through everything. Go in peace. Amen.
Thank you.